Hello everyone. So today we are going to do a lesson, The Lost Child. This is the first lesson in your supplementary reader. It's written by Mulkraj Anand. Mulkraj Anand is one of the most famous writers in Indian writing in English, Indian fiction in English. He is supposed to be the father of Indian writing in English. Now when you look at this picture, what is the thing that comes to your mind first? You can see a child holding on to the parent. What does it show? The way the child, see the parent has kept the hand and the way the child is holding firmly. What do you think would be the relation between them? What is the child's relation to his parent, or how much does the child depend on his parent? So actually this sums up what we are going to see in the story. So let's go on to the story proper. It's a time of spring, and you know that during the time of spring in most villages in India we have fairs. So it's the time of the fair in the village, and from different places, that's from the lanes, small alleys, the ways where for people to walk, all are coming in gaily dressed, colorfully dressed, because they're going for the fair, they're going to enjoy. So they're coming from different places and they're all converging towards the fair. Some are walking, some are riding on horses, some are sitting on bamboo and bullock carts, and one little boy, he's going to the there with his father and mother, and he's full of life and laughter. He's full of energy. You must have seen how when small children are taken out, how happy they are. So he is full of life and laughter, brimming over, full of laughter. And when he sees something, naturally, like all small children, he'll stand there, keep looking at it. At that time, his parents keep calling him, "Come, child, come, don't stand there." But he will keep looking at all the toys in the shops that are there on the way. From the way itself, the shops have started. And when his parents call, he'll hurry towards them. But his eyes will still linger, they will still remain on the preceding toys, the toys which seem to be going backwards. Why? Because he's moving forward. And then he came to the place where his parents were stopping for him, and he could not suppress. Suppress means he could not control the desire of his heart. He knew that his parents will say no. Still he said, "I want that toy." He pleaded, he's pleading, he's begging to them, "Please," he's requesting them, "give me that." And his father looks with him with his red eye. You know, the father is given the duty of maintaining discipline here. So his father is looking in the same familiar way, as if he's a tyrant. Tyrant means someone who's very, very strict and cruel. And his mother, because you know it's the day of the fair, so she's also in that happy mood. She holds, gives him her finger to hold and says, see, look what is there before you. It's a typical strategy used by adults, isn't it? We try to distract the child. When the child cries for something, we show something else. So in the same way, she also shows him something else. And when he looks, he sees a mustard field. So much of mustard. There's so many of plants there. It looks yellow. That's why it's pale with melting gold. Melting gold because it's yellow. And you can see it just stretching over miles and miles of land. Even land, straight land. And over that, plain land. And you can see some dragonflies are bustling about. They're moving about using their purple wings. And it's said to be gaudy because it's colorful. And they're intercepting. The intercepting means they're stopping the flight of a lone black bee. When a black bee is going alone, or butterfly is going alone, these dragonflies will stop them because these are in a big group. So the child is following them with his gaze, with his eyes. And then he's waiting so that one of them will stop and then he can go and catch them. But before he can go to catch them, then again, they will. By the time he reaches close, they will start flying again. So he could not catch him then. And then his mother calls him, come, child, to the footpath, don't go in fields. And again, he'll go back to his parents gaily, happily. And he walks abreast of them, abreastments with them for a while. But again, he is left behind because he sees small insects, he sees worms on the footpath. And the footpath seems to be teeming with them. Teeming with them means full of them. They're coming out from their hiding places to enjoy the sunshine. Maybe it must have been cold till then. So they're coming out and they're enjoying the sunshine. So he's looking at them. Again, his parents have to call him, child, come. They're sitting in the shade of a grove. You can see a grove on the side with some steps. So the grove is a typical place where there are trees. And here on the side, you can see how there are some steps there. So they're sitting there on the side for taking rest. So they're calling him. Again, he runs towards them. And by the time some flowers fall on him from the tree, and he starts looking at them, he begins gathering the flowers. By then he hears the sound of doves, so then he wants to go towards the doves. and he forgets the petals. So the child is a typical child. The child's concentration is moving from one thing to another. First he sees the insects, then he's going towards the doves, then he's seeing the flowers. So his attention is going on, getting distracted. Again they keep calling him, and again he goes, you know, capering about, capering, he's skipping, dancing, going in a very lively manner. And they take him on the winding footpath, on the footpath that goes in a zigzag manner to the fair. They go to the mustard fields. And when they reach the village, he can see so many other footpaths are coming, and they're full of throngs. Throngs means crowds of people converging. Converging means they're all coming together. They're in this place to the whirlpool. Whirlpool means the whirlpool is the place where all of these are mixed, and they all keep going round and round in the fair. And when he saw so many people, he felt repelled as well as fascinated. Fascinated because he's seeing so many different people, so he's happy to see them, but he's repelled. Repelled means, you know, you don't feel happy, you want to move away from there. He is repelled because there are so many people, it's too much of a crowd. He wonders whether he'll be able to enjoy himself. And at that time he hears a sweetmeat seller crying out, "Gulab Jamun, Rasgulla, Barfi, Jalebi," at the corner of the entrance. And so many people are going there too. And there are many sweets, they have different colors. On that you can see silver, gold and all that. So the child is staring open-eyed because his eyes are becoming so big. He's not able to even blink his eyes. He's looking at them with fascination. And his mouth is watering for Barfi because, you know, Barfi is his favorite sweet. So he would also like to have that Barfi. And he slowly says, "I want that Barfi," but he knows, you know, that his parents will not agree. So even as he begs, he knows that his plea would not be heeded. Plea means his request would not be heeded. He did listen to, because his parents will say, "You're greedy, you want to eat things on the way, you're greedy." So he didn't wait for an answer. He just moved on. He made a small attempt and he went moved on. And then he sees the flower seller. The flower seller is also shouting, "A garland of Gulmohar, a garland of Gulmohar." And the child seems irresistibly drawn. He's drawn towards it, attracted towards it. He can't stop himself. He can't resist it. He went towards the basket, and there the flowers are lying heaped one or the other. And he again very half-heartedly says, "I want that garland." But he knows his parents will refuse to buy him the flowers. They'll say, "It is all cheap. Don't buy it." So he didn't wait for them to say no. He moved on. Then he saw another man standing with lot of balloons, colorful balloons, yellow, red, green, purple. Again, the child is carried away by the rainbow glory. Rainbow glory, the multiple colors of the balloons. He wants a desire to buy them. You know, he has an overwhelming, uncontrollable desire. But again, he knows his parents will say, "No, don't buy. You're too old for it." So he walked on them anything. And then he saw there was a snake charmer. You know, he's got a flute and the snake is inside the basket. Its head is raised very gracefully. Its neck looks like the neck of a swan. And when the music comes to it, it slowly is moving towards the snake charmer. So the child, when he hears the music, he's going. His feet pull him towards the snake charmer. But he knows his parents will say, "Don't listen to such coarse music." Coarse music means which is not delicate, which is not nice. And so he went away from there. Then he saw a roundabout, and on the roundabout so many people were there, men, women, children are going up and down. And as they're going up and down, they're shrieking, they're shouting, they're crying loudly with laughter. The child is looking at them intently with a lot of concentration, and then he decides to be bold, courageous, and he tells his parents, "I want to go on the roundabout, please, father, mother." And then there is no reply. They should say something. No, no child or anything. He turns, he sees his parents are not there in front of him. He looks this side, he looks his that side, they are not there. He looked behind. Again, there is no sign of his parents. He becomes very upset, he becomes afraid. From within him, a deep cry comes out and his whole body starts jerking. He becomes scared and he starts crying in fear, "Mother, father," and he starts running. From his eyes, tears are rolling down, hot tears. His face, you can see, becomes full of fear. He's so scared, he's running to one side, then other side, this side, that side, not knowing what to do. His turban has come untied, his clothes become muddy, but he is not bothered. He runs this side, that side, continuously he runs crying, and after some time his loud cries become absorbs. He's not able to control himself. He and his eyes seem filmy eyes because the eyes are full of tears. He's not even able to see clearly. He can see men, women talking. He's looking in among all those patches of clothes, but he can't see his mother and father for them. And he thinks, why are these people making so much of sound? They go on talking, laughing. He's not able to hear his parents or see his. Again, he ran quickly and now he went to a shrine, a temple, where he saw many people. And there, every inch of space has been taken up by men and women. It's congested, it's full of crowds. But as he's running, again, his sob is to be heard, mother, father, mother, father. And near the entrance, the crowd is very thick. When adults are finding it difficult to walk, men are jostling, pushing each other. And you know, you look at their eyes, you feel that they are murderous eyes, because they are, you know, in a hurry to get into the temple. They have hefty, big shoulders. The boy somehow tries to find a way between their feet, but because of their movement, they are also in a hurry, so they are not looking at the child. They are not having any kindness for him. And he might have been trampled. Trampled means he might have been stamped on them underfoot. But he shouts at the loudest voice he can, father, mother. And a man in the surging crowd, the crowd that's moving forward, hears his cry. And he stoops, he bends down with great difficulty because it's so crowded, he can't bend. He lifts him and he asks, how did he get here, child? Whose baby are you? And he moves away with the child. And now, because the child has got someone to listen to him, he cries more bitterly. He says, I want my mother, I want my father. The man tries to distract the child. He shows him, takes him to the roundabout and asks, will you have a ride on the roundabout? The child says, no, I want my mother, I want my father. The man goes to the snake charmer. He says, do you want to listen to that music, child? He's pleading, he's begging the child, okay, listen, someone stop crying. But again, the child is shutting his ears with his fingers. He doesn't want to listen itself. And he shouts again, I want my mother, I want my father. The man took him near the balloons. He asked, do you want a balloon? Nice, colorful balloons. The child again says, I want mother, I want my father. Then he takes him to the place where the flower seller is. He says, do you want me to put a garland around your neck? Naturally, the child will say, no, I want my mother, I want my father. At last, he took him to the sweet shop. And he asked, what sweets would you like, child? Again, the child turned his face away and he only sobbed, I want my mother, I want my father. So, you can see that the thing that he does wants at first, when he is asked if he wants it later on, he says he doesn't want it. He doesn't even want to look at it or hear it or see it, nothing. What brings about this change? The change is brought about because he has lost his mother and father. He's scared. This tells us that only when we have the security of our parents with us are we able to take delight in any of the other things in our life. See, first he had seen the sweet seller, then he had seen the balloon person, the snake charmer, flower seller, the roundabout, all these things he had asked for. Now, in the reverse order, when he gets lost, all these things come, the roundabout, the balloon, the snake charmer, the flower seller, and the sweet seller. And now nothing is necessary for him. He doesn't want anything. So the lesson tells us that in the end of it all, it's our parents who are the most important for us. And that's why the boy just keeps crying in the end, I want my mother and I want my father. You can enjoy the story and you can try to think, did the boy meet his parents? And were the parents right in allowing the boy to lag behind? When they were in a crowd, shouldn't they have paid more attention to the child? So the poor boy, as we see, he's so worried and upset. Okay, children, I hope you enjoyed the story. Read the story and have a great time. Thank you.